Pastors, we need you. We need to hear from you more than just on Sundays. We need to see you walk through our communities and need to hear the words of the Lord from you. We need you to bring us out of the darkness and into the light. We are just as much concerned in advancing the kingdom of God as you, and sometimes more. Most of us are lost Mondays through Saturdays. Most of us are fighting many battles of life without anyone to talk to or listen to our problems during these lost days. Many of our churches are open only 52 or 53 days a year, depending on if it is in a leap year. The church is commanded to care for the poor and needy and to seek the riches of eternity and not so much of its members. This cannot be done when churches are collecting billions of dollars a year as a group of religion organizations for themselves and not reaching out to the poor and needy as commanded by God. A open notice to black pastors of Chicago, Illinois. For those black or white pastors that are sharing bed with the city's government on their governmental issues, there are federal laws concerning the 501c3, nonprofit laws regarding when the church and the government are sharing the same bed. Many of you that are so-called black pastors, who have high levels of self-hatred, should become closer to God and with open ears should listen to and follow your own teachings, as you attended church yourself during the 52 or 53 times a year.
We thank you for the precious gift you've given us through Jesus Christ, who took the keys of eternal death and hell. So we have victory over death and hell. The victory that we have over death and hell only comes by calling on the name of Jesus Christ. Those who call on his name, accept him in their heart, and believe that he died and rose on the third day, so they too could avoid this place called hell. Father, we thank you for all that you've done, all that you continue to do. Father, I ask right now that you would continue doing this broadcast, unstop deaf ears, open blind eyes, move on the hearts of the listener everywhere, that they too might believe and avoid this place called hell. Father, we thank you for making a way out of no way. We thank you most of all for saving us from this place called hell. We thank you most of all for giving us that precious gift, Jesus Christ, that he came, that he died, and that he rose again, that whomever may believe in their heart may not perish, but have eternal life. Father, open up the ears and the hearts and the minds of those that will hear this broadcast today to receive and believe in the mighty name of Jesus, I pray. And every heart said, amen.
Breaking news, we've recently released a report that will answer questions on this topic and receive our valuable report free.
You are commanded by God to serve the poor and needy.
Pastors, are you an entertainer on this stage of life?
Pastors, church is commanded by God to care for the poor and needy and to seek the riches of eternity. Are you a man or woman of God who are serving your own needs or that of God?
Pastors, there are people that are not enjoying life as they think less of themselves and needs your help. There will always be poor people in the land. Therefore I command you to be open-handed toward your brothers and toward the poor and needy in your land. Do what 15:11.
The poor in spirit. Jesus spoke about the poor in spirit and pronounced a blessing on them. Is Jesus talking about the financially poor? In Matthew 5:3, he said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." The poor in spirit may be those who are despised in this world. They are looked down on by many. They are humble, contrite people. The poor in spirit are blessed because they are small in their own eyes. Since God resists the proud, He gives grace only to the humble, James 4-6. The poor in spirit are not those who are not prosperous necessarily, but those who consider others better than themselves.
Hello? Is there anyone here? What was that? Tim was right about this place. Anyone? Okay, keep it together. Get a grip.
Pastors, we need you. Our neighbors need you. The family down the street needs you. We need to hear from you more than just on Sundays. We need to see you walk through our communities and need to hear the words of the Lord from you. We need you to bring us out of the darkness and into the light. Advancing the kingdom of God should be a major concern. It is very important that the population of the lost, needy and the poor have your attention, not 52 or 53 days a year or only on Sundays. Advancing the kingdom of God is not a part-time event in which the plate is passed and we all go home without true teachings of the words of our higher power. People are getting killed upon our streets of our many cities, senior citizens' homes are being robbed, and many lives are taken trying to protect our homes. Pastors, we need you. We need to see during the week and not just only on a Sunday.
John 2:19-21. Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking about the temple of his body. 16 Then I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. 17 The Spirit of Truth, whom the world cannot accept, because it does not see him or know him. But you know him, because he resides with you and will be in you. 18 I will not abandon you as orphans, I will come to you. 9 John 14:16-18. 19 So then you are no longer foreigners and non-citizens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of God's household. 20 Because you have been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. 21 In him the whole building, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. 22 In whom you also are being built together into a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. Ephesians 2:19-22. Through Scripture we know that God values our bodies. Our bodies are said to be a temple of the Holy Spirit, and we are called to take care of and honor God's temple. God's words lead us to use our bodies and the gifts He has given us to achieve the will of God. Use these Bible verses for a better understanding. 1 Corinthians 6:19-20. 19 Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. 20 You were bought at a price. Therefore honor God with your bodies. 1 Corinthians 6:19-20. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. The Apostle Paul said that our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Many people believe, it's my body, and I can treat it any way I like. But what does our Creator God say? Fearfully and wonderfully made. Fearfully and wonderfully made is how King David described God's creation of human beings, Psalm 139:14. David praised God for this marvelous work called the human body. There are several references in the Bible where the body is actually likened to a temple, John 2:21, 1 Corinthians 6:19. There is a purpose behind everything God does, and the creation of the human body is no different. A major purpose in this life is to grow in the righteous character of God. Through His dwelling in us by the power of His Holy Spirit, we are helped in achieving that purpose in life that will enable us to live forever in His family. The Apostle Paul shed light on the purpose of the human body when he told the brethren in Corinth, "For you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you." 2 Corinthians 6:16-17. Paul explained that God will dwell in man by the power of His Spirit. If our bodies are to serve as a temple or dwelling place for the Holy Spirit, does God have specific expectations about how we treat and care for our bodies? Health knowledge. There is more published today on health matters than at any other time in human history. The many studies and advances in the health sciences mean we have a much better understanding of what we can do to gain and retain a level of good health. This includes regular exercise, proper diet, getting enough rest and proper emotional health. When we do what is necessary to maintain physical health, we find our minds are sharper and better able to think, remember, learn and focus. The need for a sharp mind is just as important for spiritual matters as physical. But our world is filled with opportunities for us to abuse our bodies. Many of the typical fast foods are quite limited in important vitamins and minerals and are instead filled with fats, sugars and chemicals that actually destroy good health. High-stress lifestyles require people to push harder and work longer hours to accomplish more and more. According to the National Sleep Foundation, drivers who are drowsy are just as impaired as drivers who are under the influence of drugs or alcohol. Researchers have discovered that chronic sleep deprivation contributes to high blood pressure, heart attack, obesity and likelihood of a stroke, in addition to significantly decreased cognitive function. Lack of proper rest equals health problems. While the Bible does not condemn all use of alcohol, see is drinking alcohol as sin. It does condemn the abuse of alcohol, see alcohol use and abuse. Modern research is replete with descriptions of the negative consequences of too much alcohol. Likewise, the results of abusing drugs and other substances, legal or otherwise, have been abundantly documented. Some substances attack the muscles, some attack the lungs and heart, and many attack the brain itself. For example, see is smoking a sin. In time, the result will be health that is diminished and a body that may be broken beyond repair. This is not how God intended that we care for His wonderful creation. Your body is to house the Holy Spirit. Paul taught members the need to remember what was dwelling in them and how they would be held accountable for their care of their spiritual temple. Do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? If anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him. For the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. 1 Corinthians 3:16-17. We human beings are accountable to God for the way in which we care for our bodies. The analogy of a temple points to the temple in Jerusalem that Paul knew at that time. This temple was a rebuilt version of the magnificent temple Solomon had built long before. Later on, in 1 Corinthians 6, Paul warned the church about sexual immorality, stating, "Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a harlot? Certainly not." Verse 15. And again in 1 Corinthians 6:18 he wrote, "Flee sexual immorality." His meaning is clear: sexual immorality is a sin that defiles our bodies, making a mockery of the temple in which the Holy Spirit is to dwell. Care for the body. The human body needs to consume food for energy virtually every day. But not everything that crawls, runs, flies or swims was designed by the Creator to be consumed by people. For an explanation of what foods God did intend people to eat, see our section on clean and unclean animals. Does God care what meats we eat? We also care for our bodies with proper sleep and exercise and appropriate social activities. It is no secret that even the things we think about can impact our health. Solomon wrote, "A good report makes the bones healthy," Proverbs 15:30. What we choose to think about and even the words from family and friends can affect our health. Paul wrote, "Whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things," Philippians 4:8. God promises to give a peace of mind that can help us cope with stresses and trials that sometimes war against our temple of the Holy Spirit. Thinking about things God wants us to think about will promote spiritual health to the temple. Limitations. Of course, there may be limitations to what we are able to do to preserve our health. Part of the equation is genetic or may involve environmental factors that are beyond our control. For example, the New Testament gives us the example of a man blind from birth, through no fault of his own, John 9:1-3. In the same manner, some health weaknesses may not be caused by lack of self-discipline or failure to follow practices that would honor God, but may result from genetic predisposition or factors in our environment or life situation over which we have no control. However, given those constraints, God expects us to do as we are able to follow balanced guidelines pertaining to diet and exercise. A temple like no other. The temple Solomon built was magnificent. Many parts of the temple were overlaid with pure gold, including the altar and the inner sanctuary, 1 Kings 6:21-22. Our bodies, which are to be the temple of the Holy Spirit, are also quite special. Anything that contains God's presence is deemed holy. The body that receives the gift of the Holy Spirit is special to God and is to reflect His nature. How would you describe the current state of your temple, your body? We have the freedom to choose how we will care for this precious body lovingly designed by the Creator. It is His intent that we care for it and use it properly. Fearfully and wonderfully made is this body God created, the temple of the Holy Spirit. Let's talk a little about the universal law of prosperity. Sowing and reaping are universal laws of nature because God set them up to be universal laws of nature. These laws work in all things. Whatever is sown is ultimately what is reaped. Scriptures declare it. Here is just one. Gal 6:7-9. 7 Be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For in due season we shall reap, if we faint not. This scripture principle applies to the sowing of finances as well to sowing seed on a farm. If you sow corn, you will reap corn. If you sow cotton, you will reap cotton. If you sow tomatoes, you will reap tomatoes. Likewise, if you sow finances into God's vineyard, you will reap yourself a money harvest. This is a universal law. What you reap now is what you sowed yesterday. God showed me some years ago why sowing and reaping works with the planting of money into God's vineyard. He showed me that He quickens or makes alive the inanimate, dead money that we sow. Even a seed of corn, cotton or tomatoes dies in the ground before it can reproduce itself. Consequently, the thought of money being made alive by God should not be shocking at all. After all, He makes the corn, cotton and tomato seed come alive even though it is dead. In other words, seed money planted into His vineyard takes on a supernatural life that is capable of reproduction just like a grain of corn that the farmer sows. Get this well. Your money seed lives and reproduces itself just like a grain of corn. This requires a supernatural act of God. Think of it. When you plant a money seed, God actually makes that money live with the life of God in it. Consequently, it can supernaturally reproduce itself a hundredfold and come back to you in the form of a money harvest. Begin now to sow everywhere you can and as much as you can. This way you will have a continual harvest of money. The more often you sow, the more often you can reap. This is the miracle working power of God in your money life. When you sow money into His vineyard, you make Him responsible for your financial condition. When you do not sow into His work, you and you alone are totally responsible for your financial situation. Sow some seed today and let Him be responsible for your finances. You will be glad you did. Let's talk a little about from the kingdom of darkness. Col 1:12-14. Giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness, and hath translated us into the kingdom of His dear Son, in whom we have redemption through His blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Many things have happened in this world. Death comes to those who wait, unknowing when nor where nor even how it comes, but it comes to all. Many ministers of God's testimony of His Son Jesus are crying with bitter tears for the dead and the loss of many who have died without any hope of salvation through the rejection of the blood of the Lamb. Atonement for them is far gone and is no longer available to them whom have made their decision to follow false gods into eternity. These ministers of the truth are not at fault for the lost that have died, but the fault lies with those that chose darkness rather than light. Those who have died in sin must also be raised in sin to be partaker of the judgment of man. There is no fault in the ministers of truth. They have done their duty to God and man to deliver the truth. 2 Cor 4:5, Wesley, for we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. The fault is not in us, neither in the doctrine they hear from us. We preach not ourselves, as able either to enlighten, or pardon, or sanctify you, but Jesus Christ, as your only wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and ourselves your servants, ready to do the meanest offices. For Jesus' sake, not for honor, interest, or pleasure. The Father hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. The word translated has two specific meanings, one. The translation of the body, as noted in Scripture. To bear, carry or remove from one place to another. To remove or convey to heaven, as a human being, without death. By faith Enoch was translated, that he should not see death. Heb 16. 2. Translated as of the Spirit. Those thus translated as to state, are also transformed as to character. This is a change from the carnal mind to the mind of Christ. A change of attitude, a change in your thought process is a change in heart. There are many that believe 1:12-14, is stating that Christians, who have been translated, are immune to attack by Satan and the forces of darkness. This is a misconception and dangerous belief. The translation mentioned here is translation of the dead spirit to a live spirit and not the death of the body. A translation from a kingdom of lies and deception to the kingdom of light and truth. From being a servant to Satan to the servant of the Lord God Almighty. From being a slave to sin to being the sons of God. So long as the body is alive, it is a target for Satan and the kingdom of darkness. Still don't believe? Look at Paul for example, 2:12-7:10. And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly therefore will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake, for when I am weak, then am I strong. Paul was a preacher to the Gentiles, of which we all are. And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of their revelations this passage is. For the word of God is quick and powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing as under of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of thoughts and intents of the heart. Hebrews 4:12. Well my friends, it's that time to say may each of you get many blessing from your higher power. This month's question? Was Jesus black or white? You may just find the answer within these Bible verses. Hair, Revelation 1:14 Skin, Revelation 1:15. Once again thank you, for watching Darnell Glover's Words of Wisdom, and his Glover Gospel. It's been most enjoyable and each of you are daily in my prayers. Bye. We'll be right back.